Today's topic is, how do I know if there's left or right bundle branch block? Now, I chose this topic because I think it's been made unnecessarily complicated, and there's lots of different rules and tips and tricks out there, one of the most popular ones being WiLLiaM MoRRoW. And I think some of them are quite good, and they have their merit, but I'm going to present something a little bit more simple and easy to use. So I'm going to share with you a simple pragmatic rule to decide if there's bundle branch block and whether or not that's left or right block. Okay, so let's get started. So the rule is that you have a 12-lead ECG and you're going to look at V1. And as we know, V1 faces the right ventricle. And this is important when we look at the electrophysiology. The first part is to identify whether or not there's actually bundle branch block. And the way to do that is to look at the QRS, so the beginning of the Q wave to the end of the S wave. And if this complex is greater than 0.12 seconds, so if the QRS is greater or equal 0.12 seconds, then you have bundle branch block. Bundle branch block. Okay. And for those of you who like to think in a more visual way, 0.12 seconds is 3 small squares. So that's 3 small squares on your ECG paper. Once we've determined whether or not we have a widened QRS or a bundle branch block, then we need to decide if it's left or right. And the way we're going to do that is we're going to look for an M-shaped QRS in V1. So if we do have that M-shaped, which is also called RSR pattern. So that's an R wave followed by an S wave, which is negative, followed by a second positive R wave, which gives you, if you can imagine, an M shape, which we'll have a look at shortly. Then you've got right bundle branch block. And if you don't have an M shape in V1, but you do have a widened QRS, then you have left bundle branch block. Let's look at some of the basic electrophysiology behind bundle branch block, and that'll help us understand what we're seeing in our 12-lead ECG, and specifically in our V1 limb lead. So I've prepared a drawing of the heart with its normal electrical components. I think everyone's familiar with them. SA node, AV node, bundle of His. I'll just briefly identify our left bundle branch and our right bundle branch. Okay, let's just go through the normal depolarization of the heart. Particularly, we're going to be interested in everything that happens after the depolarization of the AV node and the bundle of His. So the very first thing to be aware of is that the interventricular septum, so this big layer of muscle here between the right and left ventricles, actually depolarizes going from left to right. Okay, so that's going to be number one. That happens first. Now, number two is depolarization of the left and right ventricles. Okay, and this happens simultaneously. So I'll call this 2. And on this side, call this 2 prime. Those happen at the same time. Now let's have a look at what that works out to be on an ECG. So I've drawn a normal depolarization pattern of V1. Now, this is our quite a chunky P wave, and then we have an R wave, and that R wave is representing the depolarization of the septum. And as we mentioned before, V1 is facing the right ventricle, so things facing the right ventricle will be positive, and that represents depolarization of the septum. Okay. Now, the S wave we see here is a deep S wave, and that represents the sum of both of these vectors here. So we've got a large depolarization of the left ventricle and a relatively smaller depolarization of the right ventricle. And the left side is going to win out because it's got more muscle mass, more depolarizing tissue. So that's going to be what we're going to see on our ECG. Okay. So our 2 prime wave is actually hidden in here. So this is, we'll just call this 2 down here. All right. So now let's look at an abnormal conduction pattern with bundle branch block. So here's another heart. And this time, we're going to produce a block. Conduction will go through the bundle of his and then through the left ventricle, the left bundle branch. And therefore, depolarization of the septum will actually be normal. Won't be any different than it is usually. All right. So that'll be normal. Now, we're going to get depolarization of the left ventricle, as we did before. But we're not going to get the simultaneous depolarization of the left and right, okay? Maybe I'll change colors just to make this point clear. All right, we're going to get a delayed depolarization coming from the left side of the heart. So the left side of the heart is going to depolarize the right ventricle. That's going to be step number 3. And what does that look like on an ECG? Well, as you can see from my rather poor drawing, this is what it looks like, okay? So number 1, we still got our normal depolarization of the septum. Number 2, we're going to get a negative deflection. That represents the depolarization of the left ventricle. And number 3, we're going to get a positive and late depolarization happening after the depolarization of the left ventricle. Okay? So let's take advantage of this opportunity to have a look at our rule. So first of all, let's look at the QRS complex. So we've got, starts here, and it's gonna go all the way to about here. Okay, so that's that QRS. QRS is greater than 0.12. Okay, it's going to be about equal to 0.14 or something like that. So we do have a widened QRS and we have a bundle branch block, okay? So the second thing that we're going to look at, the shape, okay? So I'm going to mirror the shape down here. We've got upward slope, downward slope, upward slope, okay? So that M shape, the classic V1 shape we're looking for right bundle branch block. Now, finally, I want to go over a heart conduction with a left bundle branch block. So we've got another heart here. And the first thing I'm going to do is draw in my left bundle branch block, just as I did before. Okay. So there we go. We've got block of the left bundle branch. So the first thing that's going to happen here is we're going to get abnormal depolarization of the septum. All right. So instead of going left to right, we're actually going to be depolarizing right to left. Okay, so that's going to be event number one. And almost simultaneously to that, we're going to get depolarization of the right ventricle, which is going to happen normally through the right bundle branch. All right. Let's call that 2. And finally, the left ventricle is going to be a slow, abnormally depolarizing event that's going to happen from the septum and from the left right ventricle going towards the left. Okay. So again, let's draw it in this purple color. Let's call it 3. Now, there's different variations of what left bundle branch block can look like in an ECG, because there's actually an anterior and a posterior fascicle, and it's a little bit more complex. That's why we have our rule in place saying that if it's not right, then it is left. I've drawn what one of these patterns may look like, okay? Now, on here, maybe I'll choose a different color this time because it's clearly difficult to read. So on here, we've got the first thing that's happening is actually we can see just the tiniest bit of 2. As I said, 2 and 1 are happening at the same time. So that tiny R wave is what's left of the right ventricular depolarization. Okay, so the ventricle is depolarizing as the septum is depolarizing. And actually, this long depolarization of the septum and the left ventricle from right to left is going to create this wide, deep S wave. Okay, so let's call that 3. 2 and 3 here. And most importantly, there's no M shape. And I don't think I need to even draw out that this is practically 5 small squares. So the QRS is certainly bigger. QRS is It's about 0.2 seconds, five small squares. So as promised, we're going to go over an example of an ECG. And if you've already paid attention to the entire tutorial, you probably can spot diagnose it, but let's go through it slowly. Anyhow, so I'm going to zoom in to V1. So we're going to measure the QRS duration in this first complex. All right. Not the straightest line, but you get the idea. Okay. That's 0.16 seconds. So here we have a wide QRS. Now in the second one, let's have a look at the pattern. So we're going to get an R wave, we're going to get an S wave, and then we're going to get another R wave here. So that's our RSR pattern, and that's our M shape. So here we have right bundle branch block. Okay guys, well that's it for today. Thanks for listening to the video. I hope you find the simple pragmatic rule to identifying left and right bundle branch block useful for yourself when you're in the emergency department or on the wards. I think in my next video, I will share with you some of the caveats to the rule. There are a few exceptions to when a QRS complex can be longer than 0.12 seconds and represent different pathology. As well, there are a few variations to the M shape in right bundle branch block. That's just how medicine is. Nothing is ever absolute. So I look forward to sharing those few with you. But this rule largely applies and works in most cases.